Focus.
Citi News.
It's midday. Hello, good afternoon, and welcome to the Citi Prime News. We are live from our studios at number 11, Dr. Martin Loop in Adabraka, Accra. My name is Adjoatin Krama Domina. This afternoon, dozens of teachers mass up at premises of the Labour Commission as a meet striking teacher unions over conditions of service.
We are here in the first place to solidarize with our leadership as they go through the negotiations today.
Also coming up, minority in parliament demands a bipartisan probe into $240 million expenditure for the just ended 13th African Games.
The Akufo-Addo Bawumia NPP government spent a staggering $240 million on the just ended Games. Yet, the organization and management of the event was poor and shambolic.
Still in this package, Energy Ministry defends comments by Sector Minister Matthew Opoku-Prempeh on release of a load management timetable. And later, government issues five-week timeline to find private partners for completion of the Sagleme Affordable Housing Project. We have details of these stories and more coming up your way in the next half hour. Remember, the bulletin is live on Facebook on Citi 97.3 FM. We are also live across the country on our partner stations in the Upper West region. You can find us on Tumpani Radio 88.5 in Nadoli, Drapa 96.1 FM in the Upper East region. This is Recast 92.1 FM in the Northern region. You can equally tune into North Star Radio 92.1 in Tamale in the Northeast region, Nobia FM 98.1 in the Western region, Beach 105.5 FM in Takrade in the Ashanti region. You can tune in to Focus 94.3 FM, Orange 107.9 FM in the Volta region. This is Sela Radio 97.1 FM, Holy FM 98.5, and in the Savannah region, this is Kasha 99.5 FM.
Citi Prime News at 12 midday updates you on all the running stories and connects you to the newsmakers.
A very warm welcome to you this afternoon. We begin on the education front, and teachers have massed up at the National Labour Commission premises to support their leaders who are meeting the government and the commission regarding their ongoing strike. The three teacher unions, the Ghana National Association of Teachers, NAT, the National Association of Graduate Teachers, NAGRAT, and the Coalition of Concerned Teachers, CCT, declared a nationwide strike on Wednesday, March 20, to demand better conditions of service. The teachers have said that their presence is a show of solidarity to their leaders.
We are here in the first place to solidarize with our leadership as they go through the negotiations today. We have had to do so because over the period, the Labour Commission is looking at it as a very fair practice. We have respected that. But then if we keep postponing, we are called today, come tomorrow. We are called today, come tomorrow. Sometimes the time that the invitation comes, there's no other way for us. So we feel that it's important for us to come and let them see that we are all here waiting as they meet up there.
You heard one of the teachers who have mastered by the National Labour Commission premises. Now, let's go live to the commission where my colleague Kennedy Chumesi is on standby. Good afternoon, Kennedy. Are they still in the meeting? What has been unfolding in the past hour since they started?
Okay, Adjoa, so as I speak to you now, the government and other key stakeholders are in a caucus meeting. The teachers, the teacher unions have been excused for a while for the caucus meeting to take place, and that maybe that's where they will finalize on what the meeting would today. So the meeting with the government involves the Minister of Education, Dr. Yoyodi Chum, and the Director General of the Ghana Education Service, among other key stakeholders. And for these teacher unions, they are hopeful that today will bring a finality to where the government will address their concerns with regards to their conditions of service and other issues with respect to the distribution of laptops to teachers and the rampant changes of the school calendar without recourse to negotiation with them.
Kennedy, how is it looking like in terms of body language and how the teachers are responding to whatever the first half of the meeting was?
The first half of the meeting, according to my sources, is the meeting was a bit heated among the parties involved, and they are just hopeful that regardless of the situation that they find themselves today, the teacher unions are hopeful that there will be something positive from the meeting today.
And have you had the opportunity to interact with any of them? What have they been saying?
So after the first break of the meeting, we had a chance to speak to the Andrew Carbon, who is the national president of NAGRAT, the National Association of Graduate Teachers. And their call is simple, that they are hoping that this meeting will come out with a positive result, regardless of any situation, because negotiations with the government have stalled for a while and there have been no positive outcomes so far. So the meeting with the National Labour Commission today with the government, as I indicated, the Minister of Education himself is also in the meeting. The Director General of the Ghana Education Service, Dr. Eric Nkansa, is also in the meeting. Other key stakeholders from the Employment Ministry are also in the ministry with these teacher unions. They are hoping this shows how serious the issue is with respect to the with respect to how the strike has really impacted academic activities in various tertiary schools. And so they are hopeful that with all these stakeholders in the meeting today, they are hoping to find a finality to the issues that they've been looking for as well.
Right. Thank you so much. Kennedy Chumesi is my colleague here at Citi FM and Citi TV. Well, he has been speaking to Angel Carbone, president of NAGRAT. Let's listen to him.
We are still in the process.
Meaning what?
Oh, we are in the process.
How would you describe the mood of the commissioners of the NLC?
Oh, they are doing their work.
They are waiting.
So now they are meeting the complainant. Mm-hmm. After that, they will meet the defendants. Mm-hmm. So we are waiting.
And you are very confident of the outcome of today?
I'm expectant that we get what we have demanded.
Mm. But the arguments as to whether the NLC or possibly the FOA has the mandates to deal with the matters that we've said before.
The end will determine. But for now, all our concern is we get our demands.
And you're very confident of getting all those.
I'm expectant that I will get it.
In case it doesn't go in your favor, what will happen?
I'm not thinking about it not going in my favor. All my thoughts are that it's going in my favor.
Well, you heard Angel Carbone, he's president of the National Association of Graduate Teachers, interacting with some journalists at that meeting between the NLC and the striking teacher unions. Let's stay on education because the Institute for Education Studies, IFEST, is demanding a careful review of all smart school initiatives rolled out by successive governments to help the implementation of the Ghana Smart School Project. The project was launched yesterday, geared towards equipping students under the free senior high school policy with essential technological skills as the world advances in the digital age. Speaking to City News, Executive Director of IFEST, Dr. Peter Anti, says the government should learn from mistakes from past initiatives to ensure sustainability.
We need to learn from the reasons why we've not been able to sustain these policies over the period and then use lessons to implement this, achieve its objective and last for a little bit longer. That is the main issue with this policy. But it's not a new thing that we are doing. We attempted it. I got the opportunity to review the RAG laptop in schools. One of the things that came out clearly was that at a point in time, the distribution turned into politics. So most of the students that had the laptop were students that were members of TAIN and their affiliated or expertises. I mean, those who were NDE members, they were those who were giving the laptops at that time. We don't want teaching of this. So in as much as we think and believe, that we are doing to learn from the challenges that we have had with the implementation of similar or same projects over the years and then ensure that this really.
Dr. Peter Anti is Executive Director of the Institute for Education Studies. But still on that, the National Union of Ghana Students is demanding the implementation of a strict sustainability plan to ensure continuity in the usage of the tablets.
Though it's a very good thing, we are asking that there should be a sustainability plan
so that amidst all these things, we'll be able to still have these gadgets in our various institutions. I'm told right after you are done with school, you would have to submit it back in various institutions so that we don't have cases of missing tablets and sports tablets. There should be a center that in case there's any issue with the tablet, we could be able to solve it as soon as we are hoping that a strict sustainability plan will be put in place so that students will be able to adhere to the regulations in order to have a long run of most of our students who come into the senior high school system to be able to also have access to these things.
You heard Daniel Oponchireme. He's a national president of the National Union of Ghana Students, NOGS. In a related development, the National Democratic Congress's parliamentary candidate for the Afutu constituency, Dr. James Kofi Annan, is skeptical about the government's smart schools project. According to him, several senior high schools have been earmarked to benefit from the project do not have ICT labs, urging the government to channel the funds into establishing labs that will benefit several students. He notes that most of the schools have infrastructural deficits and called on the various teacher unions to question the government about the sustainability of the project.
The smart school project is a waste of resources. It's a hopeless project. It is not sustainable and it will collapse in no time. The project supplies laptops to students in second cycle institutions and raises a lot of questions. There are thousands and thousands of secondary school students across this country. And most of these schools have laboratories, computer laboratories, that have no computers, or they have dysfunctional computers, or non-existent computers, or even some of the second cycle institutions do not even have computer labs at all. If you mean well to improve upon learning outcomes through ICT, what you have to do is to use those computers that you have acquired to resource and retool the existing broken down computer labs and set up new ones where they don't have computer labs so that they can also benefit. Every student can benefit, and it will not be for only one student. But just because we want to showcase headline news out of this project, we have decided to hand over these computers to this student.
You heard the parliamentary candidate for the National Democratic Congress in Efutu, Dr. James Kofi Annan. Now, still on education, the assistant head teacher of Pokokrom Ibrahimja Islamic JHS School, Michael Chite, says his outfit is still waiting on authorities to intervene in resolving the issue with a contractor who locked up their school over government's delay in paying monies owed them. The contractor with carpenters stormed the school while the students were writing their mock exams, ordered the students to leave the classrooms, and locked up the school with padlocks, despite a plea from the teachers and the Parent Teachers Association. Speaking to City News, the assistant head teacher of the school, Michael Chite, says despite the ongoing teacher strike, they are still looking forward to an expedited resolution to the matter.
So far, everything is in the hands of the contractor and then the DC. But up now, they have not opened the door yet. Yeah, because of the strike, we are at home now, but they have not opened it. But I don't know. We have not heard anything from them. No, we are still at home. We are still at home. Now, when the issue happened, because they said they will go and sit down and then they will say, they will come and open it. From there, I have not heard anything again.
Michael Chite is the assistant head teacher of the Pokokrom Ibrahimja Islamic Junior High School. You're still listening to the Citi Prime News. When we return, the Energy Ministry has been defending comments by Sector Minister on release of a load management timetable. Please stay for details.
Citi Prime News at 12 midday. Updates you on all the running stories and connects you to the newsmakers.
The month of March is Heritage Month on Citi FM and Citi TV, and we will be celebrating it in grand style with the theme Imagine Ghana, Discover the Unknown. We will discover the story of our people and customs, places, food, music, and fashion. Stay tuned to City TV and City FM every weekday to learn Guinean historical facts, heritage, and traditions with the on-air series on Breakfast Daily on City TV at 9:30 a.m. and on the biggest conversation on radio, the City Breakfast Show on City FM at 9 a.m. from the 1st to the 31st of March. The Heritage Month on-air series is proudly sponsored by Miss Cookie Spices. No peeling, no blending, just scoop and cook. Other exciting activities for the Heritage Month 2024 will include the evolution of High Life Music, a High Life Music expose on City TV and City FM. Curated music on Brunch in the City on City FM. What's Cooking special features on City TV. The Heritage Quiz on the Traffic Avenue on City FM. Catch the Heritage Caravan Diaries and Moments from the 3rd to the 10th of March on the Heritage Caravan. And the big one to crown the Heritage Month celebration, we will treat ourselves to delectable, authentic Ghanaian cuisine, music, dance, and many more at the Back to Your Village Food Festival from the 30th to the 31st of March 2024. Don't miss all the education, fun, and excitement on the Heritage Month 2024 this March, only on City TV and 97.3 City FM. The Heritage Month 2024 is powered by City TV with support from City FM.
City TV is live on DSTV, GoTV, and HD Plus. On DSTV, find us on channel 363. On GoTV, we're on channel 117. And on HD Plus, get us on channel 108. On a digital TV, run a new search. But take note that without an antenna, you cannot access City TV. City TV can be accessed on any free-to-air digital box, like the GoTV and HD Plus boxes. City TV, it's your world.
City Prime News at 12 midday updates you on all the running stories and connects you to the newsmakers.
Yo, welcome back. Let's bring you some more stories this afternoon. The executive director of the Institute for Energy Security, Nana Mwesi VII, has slammed the energy minister, Dr. Matthew Opoku-Prempeh, over his response to demand for a load shedding timetable. The minister rebuffed calls for a load shedding schedule, describing persons making same as wishing evil for the nation. This is despite a directive from the Public Utilities Regulatory Commission, PURC, for the ECG to release a timetable by tomorrow, March 27. Nana Mwesi VII, in an interview with City News, lashed out at Dr. Opoku-Prempeh, describing his posture as a possible setback for the ECG in releasing a load shedding timetable.
It is very unfortunate to hear a minister speak this way. For him to say that we are committing a crime for asking for a timetable goes to show the kind of position and thoughts that leaders are keeping these days. For a politician today, a timetable is an admission of doing so. That is why the minister is clear in his mind that the ECG will not produce any timetable and that they've told us already we should go and look for one ourselves. Very, very insulting. And if he claims that he doesn't know that the PRC has requested of an agency under his supervision for a timetable, means that the minister is uninformed. He is either misinformed, ignorant of what goes around him, or deliberately choosing to tell Ghanaians that he is unaware. But today, we can say on authority from the desk of IES that it is the minister that is restraining the ECG boss from providing necessary data and information as to what's happening in the sector. It is the minister, the energy minister.
The IES is also predicting that the erratic power situation will worsen from 2025 due to the liquidity challenges. Here's Nana Mwesi VII again.
But the fuel supply challenge, whether 630 transformers problem, it is liquidity challenge that's introducing some of these problems. And until we resolve this financial constraint, Bernard, doing so is going to do for us for a very long time. I pity the next government that will be formed. They are going to inherit a cliff, not a deep hole. And when you are at the edge of a cliff, when you fall, it is big and bank. Because the kind of hole that's been dug or how those have been brought. In fact, we want to call on the PRC to extend the investigation beyond the ECG to cover the entire value chain.
So are you saying that from 2025 the power situation is going to get worse?
It's going to get worse. Because look, your debt in the sector is increasing every day. Money or cash? And why we believe it's going to be worse that the managers of this sector are not even admitting the problem. The first point in addressing a problem is admitting, knowing your problem, admitting it, and finding ways to resolve it. They don't even believe there's doom. So that's why you have to.
Nanamwesi VII is Executive Director of the Institute for Energy Security, IES. He was speaking on the City Breakfast Show. Meanwhile, the Energy Ministry has mounted a spirited defense for comments made by the sector minister. A statement from the ministry signed by its spokesperson, Kofi Abrifa-Fina, says the minister was only being factual with the reality on the ground. Here are excerpts of that statement from the ministry read by Hawa Idrisu Mustafa.
The minister dismissed the need for a load management timetable because, in his view and as indicated by the Electricity Company of Ghana, the causes of the temporary power challenges are being addressed. The minister in the clip said, addressing the issues is not an event, which is rightly so. The minister's comparison of the current energy sector to the one under former President John Mahama, where Ghanaians reeled under pervasive doomsday for 4 years, comes on the back of recent similar calls in the media space by the NDC flag bearer for a load management timetable.
You heard excerpts of a statement from the Energy Ministry reacting to comments by the minister on the release of a doomsday timetable. Away from energy-related stories, the minority in Parliament is demanding a bipartisan parliamentary probe into the $240 million spent on the just-ended 13th African Games by the government. The minority says despite the huge sums of money spent on the Games, the organization and management of the event was poor and shambolic as compared to other African countries that hosted previous editions. Addressing journalists, the ranking member on the Youth and Sports Committee of Parliament, Kobna Mensah-Woyumi, says the 13th African Games held in Ghana was a monumental disaster and a total embarrassment to the country.
Showcased the sporting prowess of Africa, enhanced cultural exchanges, promoted solidarity, social cohesion, and peace on the continent. The just-ended Games were a monumental disaster and total embarrassment to our dear country. The Akufo-Addo Bawumia NPP government spent a staggering $240 million on the just-ended Games. Yet, the organization and management of the event was poor and shambolic. Quite apart from the fact that it lacked clear combined effect of economic viability, the organization of the Games lacked clear-cut policies for tourism, promotion, and trade facilitation. These would have given us some economic value for the huge expenditure on the Games.
That was the ranking member on the Youth and Sports Committee of Parliament, Kobna Mensah-Woyumi. We will stay with the minority caucus in Parliament because it is criticizing the flag bearer of the New Patriotic Party, Dr. Mahmoudou Bawumia, over Ghana's high tax regime, asserting that he should take the blame rather than shifting it onto the Ghana Revenue Authority. The minority says it was shocking that the vice president dared to attack the GRA for the higher taxes imposed on businesses and Ghanaians. Dr. Mahmoudou Bawumia, in an engagement with members of the Ghana National Chamber of Commerce and Industry on Wednesday, March 20, said the business community is being harassed by the GRA for setting unrealistic revenue targets. The minority, in a statement on Tuesday, March 26, noted that it is both hypocritical and deceptive for the vice president to blame innocent GRA workers for the fallout of a high tax regime that his government has sponsored and approved. Away from that, now government says it will not be deterred by political pressures to overspend this year. Budget overrun, which typically characterizes electioneering period, according to the government, will be tamed as it undertakes prudent fiscal measures under its post-COVID-19 program for economic recovery. Already, the International Monetary Fund has cautioned the country against going beyond its expenditure because the ongoing economic crisis was largely due to reckless spending during the 2020 elections. But updating the media in his first monthly economic update, Finance Minister Dr. Mohamed Amin Adam assured that the government will be more responsible this time around.
We want to optimize the mobilization of domestic revenue, rein in expenditures through expenditure controls and rationalization, firmly implement government's growth strategy with a focus on improving SME productivity, efficiency, and financing, given the significant contribution the SME sector makes to the growth of our economy, as well as for job creation. We want to collaborate with the Ministry of Energy to effectively implement the updated Energy Sector Recovery Program, and above all, pursue an inclusive approach to economic management. This will include instituting a joint economic roundtable with the academia to discuss topical economic issues. And this forum will seek to bring academia and policymakers to have a conversation on topical issues as they affect the economy and to propose solutions on our way forward. A Ghana Development Forum, which will be a forum to bring various stakeholders together to discuss and build consensus on key interventions such as the IMF program and our debt restructuring program. This is also intended to mobilize the support of Ghanaians for the fund program that we are implementing, which, as you know, will continue to be implemented beyond this election year.
Meanwhile, the finance minister is confident Ghana will pass all the structural targets in the next review of the IMF program come April 2024 to secure the third tranche of the cash of $360 million by the end of June.
Starting from 2nd of April to the 12th of April 2024. And this is following the successful completion of the first review of the program, which saw the disbursement of some $600 million into the economy. During the second review, the IMF mission will engage the authorities in technical and policy discussions to enable them to assess Ghana's performance on program objectives. The test date for the second review is December 2023. The approval of the second review by the Fund Executive Board, possibly by June 2024, will trigger the release of the third tranche of $360 million, bringing the total disbursement so far under the program to $1.56 billion.
That was the Finance Minister, Dr. Mohamed Amin Adam. Now, government has initiated processes to secure private partners to complete a Saglim affordable housing project. The project was started in 2012 under the NDC government is to build 5,000 housing units, has been subject of controversy after it stalled over allegations of misappropriation of funds. During an assessment visit to the project site, Works and Housing Minister Kojo Ponkrumah announced that a private partner is expected to be secured within the next 5 weeks. Two persons have been found dead in the Tubong community in the Timpani district of the Upper East Region after drowning in the Tubong Dam. The victims were identified as an 11-year-old boy who drowned in the dam and a 30-year-old man who attempted to rescue him but unfortunately met the same fate. The bodies of the two victims were recovered from the dam after collaborative efforts by rescue teams. Speaking to City News, the district chief executive for the Timpani District Assembly, Anabida Isaka, urged parents in the community to exercise caution and prevent their children from getting close to the dam to avert similar tragedies in the future.
An 11-year-old child went in to swim with a colleague and unfortunately he got drowned. So when the information got to the Tubong town, they rushed there. And when they got there, the father of the girl and the father's friend went inside to see whether they can rescue the girl. And in the process, the father's friend also got drowned. There are many dams in the area. But these dams, some portions of them are very detached. The divers, when they came, they had things very difficult. You know, this time the weather is hot. And once the weather is hot, we go to the dam to swim in order to cool our body. But it's not the best. Children go there to swim and even with elderly people. It's better we talk to our children to refrain from going there to swim. When we got to that particular dam, we could even see crocodiles in. But that does not mean that it was a crocodile that caused the problem, because the two of them, when they were arrested, there was no cut in their body. What has happened is a lesson to our people.
Anabida Isaka is the district chief executive for the Timpani District Assembly. And that will be all for this edition of the Citi Prime News, which has been live from our studio in Adabraka, Accra. For more news, please visit citinewsroom.com. My name is Ajua Tinkrama Domina. Many thanks for your company. Have a good afternoon.
Citi News, we speak first. Reach our hotline on 0302-224959 and get interactive on Facebook, Citi 97.3 FM, and on Twitter at Citi 973.